So take it away, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Well, I thank you guys for inviting us, and I had a kind of random thought to begin this, and it's not quite conversation, but it's in the spirit of conversation, and that is, I had a fantasy about this show, this name, Drew Beattie, that you, in some ways, have been doing battle against what I would call the tyranny of the proper name, and its ability to sort of guarantee authenticity or, you know, kind of branded singularity, and you do that battle by means of collaboration, vandalism.
Sorry, can you speak just a little louder?
Yeah, and feel free, anybody, to just come on in and push your way through. And yes, relatively informal, okay. Just come on in.
You might want to shut that door.
No, I think the door's good for air.
All right, good, yeah.
No, I understand.
Get comfortable.
If anybody wants to sit on the stairs.
Yes, yeah,
so it's a running start to an idea about Drew and his
beef.
His beef with the proper name as this mark of branded singularity. And he has all these tools for doing it, different painting languages, converging, battling with each other. But that in some ways you fail marvelously. Because I can stand across the street and recognize a painting by you. No matter how hard you try to destroy this thing, the singularity. And so I guess it's a way to get you to talk about, to begin a conversation about collaboration, which we're in some ways doing in relationship to your work. But you have been practicing this for a long time, and I thought if you started with that, it might be good.
Right.
Well, it's a great honor to have you here doing this with me, because we've known each other about 20 years, and I knew that you would be the perfect guy to like just talk to about all this stuff. As you were saying that, I'm thinking about my father, who was a painter, showed here at Hirschel and Adler for a long time, and was a very gifted guy in a very singular stylistic way. He really came out of a period where he was supported by a kind of regionalist school. People from that era who he had as teachers in Cleveland supported his early work in the 50s, and he made this kind of romantic realism.
And he had the name Beattie.
George Beattie, George Hirschel and Adler. Whitney owns one of his paintings. He was very successful. So I kind of grew up with this, though we were in Atlanta, where I grew up. He was going off to New York to shows. And I kind of always, since I was 4 years old, and we lived in Florence on a Fulbright, I always had a little studio. I had a little section of his studio as my studio. So I always had a studio. My whole life I had a studio. And I was always watching his Renaissance drawing skill. And for me, I remember having Christian Schumann as a student at the San Francisco Art Institute back in the late 80s. I remember trying to correct Christian wrongly on his generic way of drawing a head, because I was still lost in this sort of singularity. Well, Christian, you just don't do a nose like this, man. I mean, come on. You know, you got to, like, do some anatomy stuff. I mean, please. You know, he, of course, had a perfect command of his own nose the way he wanted to do it, and that was completely wrong by that. But I think I grew up with a sense that the diversity and conflict in me and the multiple identities I was in a constant state of application to, perhaps not unlike other people, needed a stylistic model.
Are you describing something of a family romance that somehow dad and his language and his authority had somehow worked its way into you and you had to navigate around and through?
Well, I just, the refrain in my household was, no one draws like your father. So I thought, okay, I guess not, you know. Actually, I have these sketchbook pages of his. He would, like, I would say, my hand draw an ear. And he would draw, like, out from memory, like a baby's ear, an old person's ear. I mean, amazingly. I mean, earlobes that, like, glowed, you know. And then there would be my, like, ear that at the bottom of the page, you know.
But where did you get the impulse to subdivide your voice within a specific work?
I think I'm just subdivided. I just think, I think I feel like it's not really a social observation, though it might dovetail with it. I think people now, whatever now means, 64 or 19, 2004, people are sort of increasingly accepting that they are multiple identities and have multiple behavioral patterns and play themselves out in multiple and conflicted ways. And I would say the central tenet of our time is a kind of, artistically, is a kind of conflicted hybrid. I think when we look back upon, as we now look back upon the Baroque, I think what people will see in our time, this is my little theory, my little gamble, my little soundbite, is the conflicted hybrid. A kind of conflict ushered into a place of normalcy.
But that seems to have a kind of, or maybe do you understand it as a way to resist this other imperative, which is the branding imperative, in which artists sort of craft a niche singularity in which they can be easily recognized and thrive or succeed.
Yeah, I think I've been bad at that. I really honestly, and I think this has been a big part of my teaching life, what excites me is to be in a state of wonder about artistic discovery or a bumblebee or some spilled Coke on a summer sidewalk that's making, you know, Jesus on the sidewalk. And I just want to be in a state of enthrallment with that. And so I'm following that probably to career damage. And it's not really an effort or strategy, it's just that I feel very multiple, and the collaborations, especially the 10-year collaboration with Daniel Davidson, which precedes the very beginning of this. And I should say something about the show, because when the show came around somewhat suddenly, Jason and Sarah and Austin came over, and the decision was, let's just represent this moment as is. Unexpected. I've been working with Ben Shepherd, who's a big part of the show, especially on these two big paintings up there, as a sort of private lab, 1 week a month, since September. And actually October. And a lot of work was possible to do kind of unofficially, and it served this collaboration. So this was completely private. There was no one coming over, there was nothing. And then the show idea came up and it seemed like, well, why don't we just like do what is? And so it's credited to me as a show, and it's mainly my show, but it also has this very serious collaborative component with Ben, and that's an ongoing collaboration that I hope great things come from. We'll see. It's totally an improv situation.
Well, I think of you in a way as a anarcho-formalist, that somehow all of your disruptive gestures, all of your kind of mashups and difficulties are ultimately in the service of a kind of an acute noticing, or they are exhortations to notice the little things. And I'm thinking of some of your collage paintings, your three-dimensional elements, in which it seems like they are the result of a series of crises, accidents, vandalisms, and repairs, but that in the end, somehow all their casualness become a kind of very arch formality. And maybe what you're talking about in terms of noticing Jesus in the garbage is a little bit like that.
I think some of the small ones, that one KT right there, is a successful one in this regard, and part of a big body of paintings I've been making over the last 10 years or so, and that one actually comes from 06, which start from like a 14 by 11 sort of store-bought canvas that in this case got stuffed with a bunch of stuff. I had this orange seamed cloth that went over it, and I could go through the litany of steps here, but it's a pretty simple painting in terms of its combinations and disjunctions. I think that partly what you're talking about is finding a right compression for a diversity of internal ideas. And that becomes a coherent structure which compresses life experience into a form which might rehydrate in the mind of the viewer as art.
This is kind of wonky, but what produces that compression? What would be the, what are the elements? What's the...
Well, as some people in this room who know who've been forced to be in my classrooms, I just don't think formalism exists. I think it actually can't exist because it's a verbal construction. If I say circle, that's one thing. As soon as any one of us in this room makes a circle in a context of visual cues, it's so superloaded with content-laden interpretation that I can't see any separability. So in another sense, yes, I mean, the term formal is useful in a car mechanic sense to say, okay, this is the transmission, this is the muffler, but I'm only interested in the running car. So if everything is just cut up and displayed, I think that's a loss, and I think a lot of art education fails and that it doesn't reassemble the car that can run. So the proof is in the thing. I mean, I really
so
believe...
I guess what I'm asking in a way about it is like principles of order within an appetite for disorder, I guess.
Right, because to me, this without the disorder challenging the order, there's no meaning. There's certainly no contemporary meaning I can attack, I can deal with. I mean, maybe this goes back to my dad. My dad was a totally, I mean, if you get the blessing to wake up as any version of Miranda, you take it. And my dad got to wake up in love with Italy. He had a harmonic sense that was natural to him. It was just what he needed to make, and other people wanted to buy it, and that provided my education and food and lodging, and that was all very successful. But when I grew up with that, I always felt to be in a state of crisis and disjunction. I think the Southerner in me learned how to talk, and the teacher in me learned how to talk, but I think what I actually am is in a perpetual kind of crisis internally that I'm trying to model in made things that will release that disjunction into some kind of coherency, because I think if there's not a kind of set of complete, fully firing circuits, there's no meaning.
I'm interested in thinking about how that relates to voice, I guess, within the picture. Like each painting has a kind of an address, and under conditions of collaboration, that address is something of a we, or it's a we that's been buried in disguise, like two people in a horse, in a horse suit or something, walking together, but still somehow you know that there's something challenging there.
Something's going on there.
And that it's the address of that.
It's a crisis in the back. Between the butt and the top, it's like a problem.
That's what I'm talking about.
Good place to make paintings, right? Between the guy in the butt and the guy with the head of the horse, that area right in the middle of your good spot.
I just assume this is something you would know a bit about. But yeah. It's complicated here in this room because it's, usually we look at paintings one at a time or in small groups, and we don't have a soundtrack, you and I talking. And somehow this question of the address of the work, the we that's buried within it, the multiplied self as it kind of relates here in this room.
Well, as I think you said back when I was working with Daniel, and you talked about this after that collaboration ended, the whole notion of collaborating with oneself. I mean, I'm very interested in that notion that I can sort of throw up others within my work that are actually, I am the agent of them. But, and this would be common to like theater or writing or acting, right? That I think we have some old-fashioned notions about the painter as a singular authorial voice. And frankly, something that pisses me off in our increasingly conceptualized art world is that some of the most advanced, in quotes, artists among us love to think of painters as sort of grandma's place. You know, we can go out there and still get the cobbler, because they're out there just getting those paintings done out in the barn. Meanwhile, we're doing some multi-channel stuff in Berlin, but grandma's at home still making some trees. And I really hate that notion of painters, and it's totally untrue to contemporary painters, who are as diverse and intelligent and ambitious as any other artist would have.
Well, it's especially true of work that seems marker-driven, or work that has what is understood as expressionist conventions, because that gets understood as being a kind of cry at the heart, a kind of an expression of some sort of subjective state.
Right. For years, I've just walked down the street thinking, oh, please don't make me a soggy expressionist. The truth I'm avoiding. It may be. I mean, maybe what's really great in Rita Ackerman is she's just expressionism reborn. Because I think Rita Ackerman's a great artist. And many others. And I've always wanted to couch this they're taking this super-loaded expressionist painterly way and they're unloading. And certainly, certain artists are able to do that, to take the kind of stylistic element and completely. Richard Aldrich, a great example. He takes an Abex vocabulary and he makes it like flavorless food as content. I mean, he's quite in charge of it. So it's brilliant, really, actually, and I admire it, that he can take that and completely empty out the salt, empty out the gravy, and yet it looks like a meal, but it's another kind of meal, right? So, I don't think, though, that that's really what interests me. I think that becomes a kind of tricky game, and I think what we don't want to face is there's all these giant lineages in painting which have not been tampered with much by our labels.
Well, I know from getting letters from you and also seeing the way you address yourself on the page that you always include a drawing in your missives. And so I think that for you, drawing is a social practice and maybe a solitary vice as well, but that you have found a way to make drawing part of your way of being among others. And so I think that resonates in these works. I mean, I see moments where it's the it's sort of the spontaneous maker-upper on the fly in a context.
I'm happy about this painting. This is the first one where, you know, this would be a very small secret to reveal. But if you take those big pilot markers, you know, and you open them up and you dump a whole refill into them, they're super juicy. And they work, you know, not just this way, but this way. And so you can get an incredible, all those black lines are a marker. And it's a great device on a painting, right? And I'm sure graffiti guys would come and go, like, hey, that is a boring thing, we know all about that, you're an idiot. But, because they're super skillful guys, but...
Because you're not having to go back to reload.
No, reloading. The difference between drawing and painting often is simply painting as you reload. So it's like, reloading is a loss of connection with the circuit. So less reloading, more coherency of visual cues. And, you know, I don't know, you've been getting at a lot of things about disjunction and dissonance and multiplicity and differences. And I think, for me, ultimately, what I love about painting is just, there's a rather short list of incredible demands that painting makes, and paintings have to live up to those demands. And there's a lot of painters in this room who I will not name, who live up to them brilliantly, and I think that's, yourself included, and it's like that is, whatever your divergence, whatever your liberties taken, if something is essentially frontal, bounded, and somehow living within and on the fiction of the wall, to me it's a painting. So it better get its business done. And it may not be a conventional way of working, it may be, I mean, there's just so much work in here. Picabia in the 20s, Motherwell in the 30s, you know, there's so much work, Rauschenberg in the 60s, there's so much work which has challenged the conventions of painting and still made a case for living within painting. I think one of the zones that extends painting that we have to accept for its own the vitality of the medium is that painting plus a sidecar of questionable painting will be painting.
Sure. And we need that questionable painting.
Questionable painting.
But it's because it seems like what we're in the business of doing is finding new ways to make coherence. That coherence is a kind of an evolving condition that reflects what it's like to be alive now. And so whatever its thought rhythms, the adaptation of an individual to the language, to their times, is something that's reflected in, what is it, the quality of the way a thing hangs together.
Right.
And so what is that? How do you address that? It's a very complicated thing. You know it, you have to kind of vex it, you have to sabotage it, and then you find it somehow. Or at least you, this seems
I
like
you're... As an individual, you can't escape a certain, on some would label this rampant subjectivity. I think it's less subjective than people think, but I think, for me, looks good is good. And it looking is huge. Looking is profound. And I feel like we've had a bit of a hijacking in art academia and maybe a lot of criticism about what looking means. I think often looking is synonymous with some sort of handsome sauce or some sort of aestheticized, a sort of slightly regrettable decoration. I think that's idiotic. I'm just enraged by that. I think that the coherence you're talking about is something we all know to be a constant search. We as humans are navigating the world by constantly checking our own pulse. We are constantly looking for linkage and connection to interpret possible meaning, self-location, some sort of GPS of the mind. That is happening constantly, and when our eyes lay upon some arrangement of elements, we are looking for some kind of coherency in order to have meaning from it. As Gustin said, we're meaning makers. We're looking for that. So even something like the painting behind All Fronts here, which may have all kinds of disjunctive combinations of painterly and appropriative photography, if it can't get itself together into multiple circuits of connection, it is nothing. If it's just a style menu, and we've all seen these paintings where it's like, oh, clever, this guy's so smart. Ooh, a little riff on this, a little chinky chink, a little ding ding. And it's like, and you just go, you're depressed. Because you see all that skill, and yet it's a hollow achievement, and I don't think as an individual you can escape believing in your own agency of interpretation, which you say, that's got it right, and get out.
I like that. It's a technical term, chinky chink. I want that to be more like.
And I think there's a ton of people in the room. There's a ton of people in this room who know this. I mean, you worked on a painting, and it's just going down. I mean, it's just, you know, it was just. it was really okay at 4, and now it's 8 p.m., and it's just like, you know, I had it, I could have gone home. And then somehow it rallies inexplicably, it seems, maybe you can analyze later, in which some sort of thing enters the system of the painting, and it rallies itself up into a right self-mockery, multiple possible linkages open up, the painting seems suddenly 10 times better. How did that happen?
Right, which that's a spectacular shape. You can't know, because we can talk ourselves into anything. And this habit of our minds to make coherence means that it's impossible to not have it. So how do you find the thing is right at the limit, you know, that actually resonates in a way that maybe can kind of insert itself outside of your private experience in the kind of broader language, the history, the culture?
I think on some level, everybody making paintings has to believe that their private experience is hooked up to some informed understanding of history and tradition, and risk arrogance in saying so. I don't think there's a way out of that, because if you've been a student of art, if you've gone and stood before the great paintings that are available in New York, and I myself am fresh from the Polka show this afternoon, so I'm very small indeed, after going to see that, which I knew would be great. I think you have to kind of assert that you're channeling a kind of understanding of history and tradition, and if you can't summon the confidence to believe that, I think you're screwed. So that your assessment is not necessarily so subjective, but maybe joining a company of informed others, of which you are one, that can say, you know what, that thing is right. Or it's right enough. Or it takes a stance that can be claimed by others, and maybe many will fall away from it and not want to look at it.
Whether it's crafted, that the work is crafted a set of ratios, of differences that somehow include quantities of personal experience that can then be understood by others and maybe even do, and I feel this is something that painters have this itch to kind of sort out what it means to be technology within mass culture, within commodity culture. And so what are we doing? Are we doing something that's kind of critical? Are we an inconvenience? Are we like a little voice? Is the intimacy of like art and the way we look at it a kind of resistance? And I think those are kind of interesting questions, and maybe we don't have to worry about them too much.
Well, in truth, I mean, and this will be true again of many people in the room, you can make smart claims and contemporary claims for why you do what you do, and then maybe you just do it because you've got to do that thing. And, you know, you're playing drums in the basement every night because you've got to play drums in the basement, maybe you're not a good drummer. You know, so you can do that, but on the higher side, you know, I just think that, it's, I don't know, there's a possibility in painting that I don't see in any other way of making art. And to me, the thing that moves me the most about painting is it's something like the closest thing to a human. It's what you see and what you see through it over time, one question and the other.
Well, in terms of the address, like the sort of original question about what the voice of the thing, I mean, there is something about the unique object made through a series of touches that's looked at by one other person within arm's reach, and they can ignore it or put their nose on it and think about it any way they like, and that the intersubjectivity between the work, or the kind of dilated intersubjectivity between the artist and the viewer, is intimate and free.
And that's the painting's basic main obligation. I mean, if you don't want to look at it, it's over. I mean, I'm very interested in paintings that you refuse on first looking. That hold on to you long enough so you're still saying it's no good 5 minutes later, but you're standing there. So how no good is it if you're still standing there? All of us go into galleries and pivot in 3 seconds and go like, no, not today, I can't do that job. You know, and that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about you're in front of the thing and going like, no. And then you're still, maybe, you know, and you're working with it. And I think those are the paintings I really value making if I can make them. People have talked to me about work being kind of uncanny or grotesque or upsetting, and I worry it's just not that enough.
It would be more true of a painting at David Zwirner than it would be a painting at some other place, right? Isn't there a kind of contextual feature to that? I mean, annoying feature, but I think, you know, this standing before the thing and thinking, bullshit, this is not right, but why is it here? Why do I have to have an opinion about it? And maybe it turns out somehow that that causes a pause. Maybe this is not something we should talk about here.
But no, but I mean, the polkas are this way. I mean, I was surprised that David Stanley knows these polkas that I know very, very well, and he's been such an incredible influence on so many artists. And some of them really are like, wow, that's not really good. That's really kind of raw. It's not really good. Like, but it's real good. And then you kind of go like, wow, look how he did this thing with the devil and the Paganini thing. And look how he did this mouth and this Ride of Infinity thing. That's not really been worked on. I don't know, Sigmar. You know, and then you back off and like, no, it's just some kind of right sequencing. Everything about a painting to me is about this kind of massive compression of timing and of performance. And of course, polka, more than anybody can think of, is the creator of the performative stack, as painting.
Yeah, painting is behavior, which will always be, like, what a strange thing to do. Why did you do that? And so, you know, it's acting in a way.
And it's hooked up. It's hooked up.
Sometimes it's deep, real acting, sometimes it's phony, and we have feelings about that. But I have an impulse because I know there's a lot of brain power in this room.
Way too much.
No, you don't stand up. You stand up.
I see too many people. I'm
volunteering to retire so that these excellent interlocutors can rise and throw some questions at you, or some jars or something.
Gary.
The word you used more than any other word was meaning.
Was what?
Meaning.
Meaning, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And is that one of those kind of, you know, when you see it, or can you really fill that in?
I would just say linkage is meaning.
You know, we know what meaning is when we say, like, what do the footprints of the animal in the snow mean?
Yeah.
But it tends to get used in larger ways that I always thought were strangely inappropriate, where we don't quite know how it fits.
Like meaningfulness.
So the fact that it was almost like your benchmark. Every time you go back, you say, well, it's got to be about me. Right. And I thought, you say it's circuitry?
Language. I think that's the delivery system of it, right? Yeah. So that doesn't necessarily mean just generically that's all there is. I mean, I'm a little bit reminded, and I don't mean this anyway as a refusal to your question, but I remember hearing a radio interview with David Cronenberg. And somebody asked, well, what's that film mean? Like, what do you mean, what does it mean? What does my life mean? What do you think? I mean, it means everything. So one of the things I find the most exciting, when I walk up on my thesis, the Moroccans, it means everything. For me, it's a spontaneous capture, as if this is possible. I get the sensation of, in reductive form, a spontaneous capture of my whole life.
Now you're sounding very German. I'm wondering if maybe there's think about German art, and, you know, I'm not going to ask you about Heidegger or anything like that, but it does seem like you have a kind of instinct that renders you sympathetic to various developments in post-war German art.
Definitely, usually. For me, I think actually, and Steve won't remember, we were walking through shows in Chelsea once, and I'm going to quote you, Steve, and I can't help it. So you just looked, turned, we were like, you were walking ahead of me, some kind of construction, and then you turned and go, the Germans took over painting in 1968. And I went like, wow, really? And ever since then, I always think of that, like, maybe, really? Yeah. So, you know, it's like, I don't know, it was just such a crazy statement. But
how many
actually,
drinks have we had before
that? Actually, I don't think we've had any yet. So it was
and the avant-garde died in 1879.
Yeah, all these dates become kind of tricky, but and of course, there's so much good work going on all over the place. But it is interesting to realize how long it took people like Polk and Kippenberger to be acknowledged here in New York to the extent that they really needed to be. But going specifically back to this meaning issue, one kind of meaning I'm very dubious about is the very literal, illustrative, wall texty, press releasey kind of meaning in which someone is, and this I think afflicts art academia at the moment, in which students are taught to announce their concepts, and then illustrate them and make it all work out. And I want to go crazy and scream and lie down and bleed. And I just, you know, I can't, I mean, you know, but you're right to point out it also isn't just a wash, you know, of some, whatever. So for me, the paintings individually have some very specific things going on in them that I respond to, often combinations of emotional tone or types of emotional experience. Or disjunction, certain degrees of jangliness versus harmonic connections, but they're always very general and very multiple and open to interpretation. And I almost always go wrong if anything more specific comes in. Like this painting, for instance, was very hard to title. And the title that settled on it was very funny. During the installation, we sat in here and we were listening to Elton John's Tiny Dancer. The suggestion was Tiny Dancer, so somebody got up on a laptop and thought, yeah, it's like Tiny Dancer. There's like these little kind of, you know, funny figures.
Clearly,
yeah, like that. Yeah, it says Tiny Dancer. And I thought, like, but that won't hold, you know, because titles are tough, and a lot of artists think, what are you messing with this verbal shit? Just title it 186X, you know, something like that. But I think titles can be great. So then this title came up, Masters and Chicken, which is pretty dark. And I thought, yeah, here are these sort of telegenic people which have been messed with in the painting, who are kind of in a remote place from all of this slightly sexy, amorphic sort of, you know, figuration. So it's kind of like one class and another class of people. Dangerously close to a social observation in my case. So I'm a little worried about that title directing the viewer toward a kind of disjunction of classes or human types, and I'm not sure the title will stay.
Yeah. But Gary, do you have a thought or a beef or a kind of...
I actually think... I think it was originally... Because I have this problem, just what Drew was saying about everybody has to start the meaning out in school. I mean, half my students are in tears over this. I mean, literally. I have one crack up on my last week. So what I said to them is, I think meaning was one of these locally useful words when it's attached to some material process, like the animal's tracks in the snow. You say, what do they mean? It means they went through it 4 a.m. and they went north. That's the meaning. What happened is this very useful intellectual tool got disconnected, and people started saying, hey, look at the dark sky. What does it mean? It's just it's a misapplication. It's just a category error. So I'm very dubious of it. Although I think, on the other hand, that we sometimes get in the presence of things and we go, oh my God, something's up here. And that maybe is what you're talking about.
I'm reminded of the famous Gustin quote, which I'll paraphrase a bit from a talk he gave, I think, in Minnesota years ago. Or maybe it was from some other piece of Gustin, where he was witnessing a couple of guys talking philosophy on the street. And they were very smart, you know, they were talking to certain French philosophers, and he's listening to this. And he begins to notice how one guy's pants shift as he moves to make a comment, how the other guy's pants work. And he left the situation thinking, the pants were really good. Like, the pants were really meaningful. The philosophy chat was not so good. So, I mean, I would go with the pants. And I'm inevitably my own judge of that, for better or worse, and stopping the painting where it stops and saying, I think that thing is hooked up to something that others will find. And if it's not, I'm screwed, or not screwed, or something. And I do think, maybe more than you do, that there is a generality of meaning that comes with the texture of a speech made on the street authentically from one person to another, or the tone of a writer's sentence structure that may not actually be describing a plot, but just be credible. And I think the painting has to be believable in those terms.
We could say that if somebody addresses a painting, or that they interpret a painting, and they bring all the interpretive tools they have to muster. They might be like brilliant, and they understand the context and the history of the language as it bears on this individual, as it intersects with those things, and that you could say that in a way that they are producing meaning from their experience with the thing. And so maybe that's not the job of the artist. Maybe it's part of the job of the artist. But that ultimately the thing goes out and becomes a kind of object of interpretation, whose result might be something we call meaning.
The problem is that often the meaning, like Gary was saying about the students, is supposed to be restricted to one thing, right? It's supposed to have that meaning and that meaning.
But that's a narrow idea of meaning.
Yeah, absolutely. But I on the same subject, I sometimes think of it as the difference between meaning and being. I mean, you were talking about the physical relationship with the painting and all, you know, the kind of intimacy of concentration that you have with the painting. When I see a painting that really has a powerful effect on me, it happens to me as a thing. It's not really something I'm thinking about in the way that I would be thinking about interpreting tracks in the snow or something like that. It's an experience. If the painting doesn't become an experience, then it doesn't matter what it means, really.
But then, can you? What happens when that experience then becomes a memory, and you then put some consideration to what that experience was?
Right.
Would that then be a production of meaning? I mean, maybe a little arcane.
No, yeah. I think it's wide open. But I just meant the actual moment of confronting the painting itself, not in thinking about it.
I guess I'm thinking about this idea of the oscillation between subject positions in the production of a painting, and then in the looking at it, and then in the reflection upon that, as you then proceed into the next work, and the imperatives that are a result, that this thing of meaning is just one of many elements that go into the kind of chaotic turbulence, productive turbulence.
There's something else that just to throw in, I think that probably a lot of people in the room agree about this, maybe some don't, but I think what you're partly talking about, Steve, when you're saying, like, you know, you have this experience in front of the thing. I mean, I think a kind of sensory intake of the thing, a kind of sensory intelligence as opposed to an intellectual, analytical reduction and sort of detective work that schools are now too much teaching people to do.
That's what you're talking about.
Which I think is really divisive and ultimately somehow feels compelled through many things, historical correctives, theoretical permissions, whatever, that to be intelligent one must look at it this way. And I think there's something quite primitive about an amazing experience in front of a painting, that it has a kind of presence that you're taking in, that its meaning, to go back to this overly generalized word, but that its meaning is seeable.
Sealed?
Seeable.
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 Nelson Goodman, in a book called Languages of Art, talked about in terms of this idea of having an experience. He said, listen, there are all of these problems with questions of intent in art. Because what happens when you pick up a beautiful rock on a beach and it captures your attention in the same way that a beautiful painting or any other thing of beauty captures your attention, and yet there's no intent? It's found art. Okay, so he says, let's really talk about what's happening to you when you're having an aesthetic experience. And he says there are four symptoms that are, and this is in no particular order. First, the thing that's capturing your attention is semantically dense. It's dense with meaning, many meanings at the same time. Second, it's relatively replete with influential factors. So that if I were to look at a painting or some work of art and say, don't change a thing, it's all working. Or don't, when you say don't change a thing, what you're really saying is there's more than one thing happening here. Mm-hmm. Third, the thing is, if not the best example of itself, a really good example of itself. Example, a haiku, 5-syllable line, followed by 7, and then 5 more make haiku. Right?
Was that haiku?
Yeah. And then the fourth thing is that the thing is a metaphoric example of something. So that if I go to a piano and play a minor chord and say, what just happened, a bunch of people in the room will say, sadness. Okay, not a guy touched a piece of ivory that made a string vibrate at a certain frequency. So he's simply saying that in this nature of having an experience and what it means to have an aesthetic experience, which he ultimately would say, to your point, is the meaning, okay? That there are these four symptoms of that and that there's not much more you can know beyond that. So you can play with the different meanings, but if you're arrested by something, are operative, and if it's a masterpiece, chances are you've got a raging case of an aesthetic experience, right? You've got chicken pox, tons of pox, feet are ache, you know, the whole thing.
Well, that's why this question of meaningfulness, we say, you know, I just saw the show, it was incredibly meaningful to me. But it doesn't mean the thing that you're talking about, which is this kind of, like, limited notion of...
There's something fundamental, though. I mean, I think that we're all saying this. I mean, maybe we're making different judgments about it, but... I mean, really, what else is going on? But I mean, we only have our life experience. We only have what we know as living people, experiencing and collecting experiences and telling ourselves stories about it and dealing with that. That's all we have, really, whatever field of knowledge, whatever it is, however complex or simple, whatever. So when art's being made, it's inevitably some sort of handling of that, reduction of that, compression of that into some kind of form, if you're making things, which paintings are, wonderfully, that then reissues them, has the possibility of reblooming those things back at you. I just don't think there's anything else going on. I mean, I think that's what meaning is. And we can isolate individual points that people want to make that might be particularly personal or confessional or sexual or political or whatever. But they will have to swim within this larger possibility or they'll become thin and fall away.
It's kind of like a prime number.
Bit. And those criteria, many people will make a different list of four. Those are good. That's a good list.
But I feel like this sounds all very smart and high-minded. Mm-hmm. But I feel like there's another side of your work which is really important, which is the kind of punk, fuck you, let's just, you know, be a little bit anarchist here and destroy. And I think that seems to me like a very exciting part of what you do, that you capture something that's caught between some kind of mad ambivalence.
Everybody in the room can make their autobiographical comments. I'll make mine. I mean, I'm, you know, a white boy from Georgia who was weighed 265 when I was like 20 years old. I was a fat boy, shy. I was a hermit making drawings instead of book reports. I had a spectacularly talented father. I was never a member of anything. And I think that for me, some kind of disjunctive grab-ass thing of like trying to sort of put this stuff together feels truthful, and the aggression that's in it is coming from a certain place of wanting to capture all of that experience, all of that non-membership, all of that diverse confusion of identities, and somehow put that together. If I was to list the things I most want in my work, of course they're very subjective words like beauty. I mean, beauty, disjunction, world making. If those things for me are happening, I don't want it. And if it's too harmonically present, I go, that's not truthful for me. So if I could make a Mirandi, of course he would say yes. He would say yes if it was possible.
Your dad would love you a little
more. He would love me. I must say, my dad loved me. My dad really, he came to all the shows, you know. I mean, he came and he was looking at stuff, he had to hate it. I mean, my son. You know, he had to look at it. Because for 10 years, I was like a realist. It was like a California realist. I made these little, I have paintings of bungalows. I mean, I would get in there and I'd be doing the Toyota. And I would think, okay, on the license plate, I buy a little Frankenthaler on that license plate. But it was like this big, you know. And so eventually I just said, I can't do it anymore. October 8th, 1984, I stopped doing that. And I started the next day working out of my head. I just couldn't paint another house with 1,000 roof tiles, all slightly different grays. I couldn't do it. So I did have a period where I was my father's son. I was really getting it done. But he didn't really care. Like all artists, he was lost in his own dreams and fiction and studio life. And he was perfectly happy to love me, however mutant or harmonic. So it was really, as we all know, what we carry inside that we internalize that runs us, not the parents anymore. So I don't know. I think that what you're talking about, I'm not really aware of it in those terms. I think, Gary, you were saying some things to me about these paintings where I was like, they're violent. You're doing these acts of violence. You know, control yourself. You know,
I had control.
A little shot. But, I think people do see that, and that's a fair interpretation. I mean, I think this head above Alterns there is a very disturbing head. That's a very unfortunate situation happening around that mouth. And it's like, what's going on?
It's the classic proof of the power of images, right? Yeah. I think it's, I can't remember his name, David, who wrote the book called The Power of Images. He says, Freeberg, thank you. Pull out an image of your mom and take the scissors out and gouge her eyes and see if you feel anything.
See, one of the things I love about painting is like in this painting right here with this guy, which was cut out of the subway, in the act of gluing the guy down, the glue and the piece of sort of plasticized paper made this kind of beautiful wrinkle which modified his own flesh and modified the image. So the fusion of just that little moment of painterly making stuff with the image, those kinds of combinations in painting to me, we're not talking about those particularities too much right now, but those things make the work. If there's anything good in here, it's because when you look at it, your eye is traveling in a set of decisions you want to engage, argue with.
But I love how you tried to fix it. Like you got the sort of clear sill skin color, and you know the problem of the wrinkled paper You tried to correct like a restorer of...
I kept those two images of that guy. I cut them out of the subway somewhere, and I kept them for years, never finding a penny to use them. And he's like an actor who probably was in some kind of former important role, I don't know who he is. And his eyes are just a little watery. And it's so sad, you know? And I just thought, oh, I've got to use him in something, and so he hung around. This, I'll just comment on something a little bit quickly, technically. This painting went on for like 4 years. But I mean, it's probably the most difficult and grotesque painting in the show.
I love how it rubs up against the blue and white one upstairs, because that has the feeling of something that you just kind of got started, you just started and then pulled out. So maybe.
I should talk a bit about that, because that is a painting with Ben Shepherd, and it was one of these just very recent collaborations, and I certainly owe a ton to him for that, because it's really, really, truly a collaboration. I think that that painting was, you know, after the mocha got made, which I took a lot of kidding from him, because I was mixing that mocha color on that painting for about 4 hours. I had like 3 buckets of mocha. Sign of a bad color mixer, I shouldn't have confessed that. Then the painting was a 10-minute spin-out. That was it. And gesso, you know, putting the gesso on, roughly painting this blue line into it, and it sort of found some right spaz out and was done.
There's a behavior attached to it, like you ducked out.
And what was interesting in the show, I hope, was to put together paintings which are more hard won, and having them a kind of difficulty and kind of yikes, you know, you're seeing somebody at the airport who's had a clothes crisis, plus a sweat attack, plus is reading 4 books that can't, you know, you're looking at that person in the airport lounge, and you think, you know, I'm okay, because, And then there's another painting that's just kind of a natural athlete. That's just like, I can throw a ball 200 miles, you know, or 200 yards, whatever. So that painting has that. Of course, for other people, it may just look as spazzy, I don't know.
Yeah. All my favorites.
Yeah. And
I see a question.
Hey. I know that layers in your painting process are very important, I'm not going to ask to what extent the actual layering of material on the surface of the painting is related to the layers of meaning, because maybe that is beyond the point, but in terms of the production of meaning, I'm wondering to what extent those layers somehow are identical of your process of thinking of and decision making need to cohere on the surface in order to have that impact, that emotional response that is triggered in the viewer, or on the contrary, they need to be visible so that you can have a map of the artist's art making process.
Well, this notion of process is something that's, of course, talked about all the time. Sometimes it's talked about, I think, in an almost socially corrected way, whereas that to be engaged with process is to be less engaged with commodity or product. I've often, I don't really buy this. I mean, I think if Velasquez came dusty out of the grave, he'd say, hey, I got a process for you. You know, I mean, it's like everybody's got a process or they don't have anything. And that's just the nature of making anything, I think, has a process. So I'm not really interested in revealing the process. I am interested, though, maybe this is a bit of a contradiction, in that it's wonderful to have visible, in the end, a painting which presents its history. So again, I'm probably promoting process here in that sense, in that it's part of one's risk in believing in its pathways of possible interpretation. That you're seeing it play out so that the field on which it's made remains. And other decisions and cancellations remain that are optically, forensically decodable. It's seeable. The sequence is seeable. And yet the painting does its fiction. It accomplishes some sort of human connection with you.
Well, ideally, right? You want those two narratives to rub against each other, right? The narrative of it's like the fiction of its coming into being,
right.
Of its being made,
right.
As a result of a behavior, and the fictions generated from the images inside of it.
Yeah.
And then if you can get those two to braid in a way, or collide, or however you imagine it.
I think you know, whether it's termed a masterpiece or not, I think what comes with that way of thinking about work is the notion that the thing is at a really maximum level of internal self-linkage, so that everything is benefiting everything else in synergistic ways that just won't quit. So the thing just won't quit on you. It just seems to be exploding in your head. You know, this is a combination. Those are, of course, some of the greatest images that come down through civilization from all cultures that we have them and we regard them.
What about this kind of mad participatory solicitation in which the thing looks like it's been come about as a result of a lot of additions and subtractions, and that you stop, and that you actually could keep going?
Right.
And that maybe part of the spectatorial participation is imagining, well, what I would do next, or I wouldn't do this, and perhaps, you know, like, it's a kind of an identification with the feeling of what that mark would be like, and maybe involves some version of mirroring neurons, and an identification with the...
I'm sure this is true for many people sitting here, that, you know, so many paintings of mine aren't finished the day they were finished, in fact. They sit around. And I go like, really? You know, ouch, really? And it's like, you kind of hang on to it and then you realize it's done. Something in you had the sense to quit and get out. And I think for a lot of people coming up in painting, one of the things you must do is to suffer the discomfort of not knowing.
So the last gesture is executive.
Yeah, you just say, no, that's cooked, you know? And you know it, and you may not know it at the moment, and yet something in you knows to get out. And at least go through that. It's easier to go back and fix it. And for me, often one of the ways I have of leaving, which is kind of maybe like coming from the Dizzy Gillespie school of how to blow a trumpet, which would not exactly be good technique, you know, the blowfish technique, would be to, I don't mean to do this, but I'll find something in the painting to which I can bind all my anxieties. And I'll interrogate it daily. A dot, a drip, the piece of black. And I'll go in and I'll be like, You preventing me from the happiness, you. And meanwhile, the whole painting's happening. No one comes in and cares about that piece of black. But for me, it's like, oh I don't know about the black. There was one painting where a dot was this, a dot. And I executed the dot too well. I practiced. And so I'd done like, oh, and it was like a perfect circle. And I went like, it was supposed to be kind of ovoid and a little bit incomplete. And it was like, oh, and it just like went, that's a perfect circle. And I thought, oh, too perfect, too good. But you couldn't touch it. So then I would go in and I would just interrogate that thing every day. Until eventually I just gave up out of exhaustion. The painting's fine. The painting had totally been fine. But I didn't want to face all the anxiety of the other decisions.
It was irradiated by your suffering.
Suffering. Yeah, it's a certain kind of suffering. It's pretty privileged suffering. No, but I think it's a mystery, and I think one of the greatest things you do when you're making art is you chance these combinations, and they might come together and echo something you know in living. And that, I mean, what kind of mission is that? It's an amazing mission. I mean, it's an incredible mission. I think everybody that's involved in this, I have a feeling it's just about everybody in this room, is trying to put together some kind of compression or form or way that will capture that and re-release it. I mean,
True. I think that is a fine concluding remark. I've been here for an hour.
Yeah, I think so.
And there's some wine.
Yes.
I do want to say,
I forgot to say that Drew has a show opening on 191 Henry Street. Because now we have two galleries, this one and Park Utopia. May 30th, he's going to have part two of the show. So we'll get you to talk again. There's a lot of interesting things were said, things you can really sink your teeth into. So maybe I wanted to add that, and then maybe we can just
Yeah, please feel free to mingle, have some wine. Thank you, you two. That was brilliant.
Now, wouldn't really.